Hello everyone! Welcome back! Nintendo is a Japanese electronics and video game company. The company was founded in 1889 and originally produced handmade playing cards. Nintendo distributed its first video game console, the Color TV game, in 1977.
素晴らしいボールの変化、鮮やかな球色のカラーがゲームの種類によって変わります。ラケットの大きさやボールのスピードが変えられるので、ハイテクニックなゲームが楽しめます。見るテレビから遊べるテレビへ。15種類ものゲームが楽しめるカラーテレビゲーム15,9800円のカラーテレビゲーム6もあります。
It gained international recognition with the release of the Nintendo Entertainment System in 1985. Since then, Nintendo has produced some of the most successful consoles in the video game industry.Play the system with the most arcade hits, you're playing with power. The Nintendo Entertainment System, now you're playing with power. Such as the Game Boy, Nintendo Entertainment System. The Wii.
With online play, you can compete with people across the country and from around the world. Keeping up with online communities to get motivated and stay active.
And the Nintendo Switch. Has also released many video games, including Animal Crossing, Donkey Kong.Mario Brothers
and change levels like never before.
Whoa, want to play?
Imagine, create, and play your very own Mario levels. Anyone can make it, everyone can play it. Super Mario Maker, only on Wii U, rated E for everyone.
And The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild.Here is a video.
system. Now you're playing with power.
There's no company as synonymous with video games as Nintendo. Originally founded as a playing card manufacturer in 1889, Nintendo took the game industry by storm nearly 100 years later. Clever marketing and sheer luck played roles, but it was a lineup of one successful game console after another that put Nintendo above the pack. Nintendo broke into game consoles with the Color TV game series. They're plug-and-play units with built-in games. Most of the games amount to variations on the same concept and shamelessly imitate popular titles. The Color TV Game 6 and Game 15 feature different versions of a Pong clone called Light Tennis. Game Racing 112 offers a top-view racing game, Block Breaker has breakout-style titles, and Computer TV Game features the strategy game Othello with the option to play an AI opponent. If Nintendo's TV game series was a modest success at best, their next attempt proved a hit. Designer Gunpei Yokoi devised the Game & Watch handhelds to play simple games on an LCD screen. Over 47 different Game & Watch models were made, including adaptations of Nintendo arcade staples like Mario Brothers. The Game & Watch series lasted until 1991, but its biggest contribution came early. The 1982 version of Donkey Kong introduced a major Nintendo innovation, the cross-shaped directional pad. Inspired by the success of Game & Watch, and perhaps envious of the Atari 2600, Nintendo again took aim at the home console market. Designer Masayuki Uemura gave the system novel features. The wired controllers used the same directional pads as the Game & Watch, and the second controller housed a microphone. Officially called Family Computer, it soon earned the nickname Famicom, as it enjoyed roaring success in Japan. The system had support from many third-party companies, and shortly after its debut, Sharp even manufactured a TV with a built-in Famicom. With the Famicom's popularity growing in Japan, Nintendo began negotiating with Atari to release the system in America. The deal fell through, but that wouldn't stop Nintendo, as they were about to change video game history forever. By 1985, game consoles were all but dead in North America. A market crash had wrecked Atari and its competitors. Consumers and retailers shunned console video games. With this in mind, an undaunted Nintendo brought the Famicom to the US. Carefully avoiding the label of video games, the Famicom hardware became the Nintendo Entertainment System. Uemura fashioned it to resemble a front-loading VCR. The initial NES bundle also introduced the robotic Rob to sneak the system into toy aisles. The NES launched late in 1985, and by Christmas of the following year, it was a runaway hit. Games like Super Mario Bros. And The Legend of Zelda propelled the NES to the status of pop culture icon. America wasn't just playing consoles again, it was playing Nintendo. While the Famicom and NES looked different, they would get the same appearance in 1993, when Nintendo redesigned the systems for both Japan and North America. As the NES dominated America's console market, the Famicom reigned in Japan. Nintendo released the Famicom Disk System, a drive that attached to the Famicom and offered games in a cheaper, semi-rewritable disk format. For newcomers, Sharp combined the Famicom and its disk system in the Twin Famicom. While the disk system stayed in Japan, it contributed to the NES. Metroid and The Legend of Zelda started off on the disk system before they became NES titles in North America. Nintendo hadn't forgotten portable games, and as the Game & Watch series waned in 1989, Nintendo introduced the Game Boy. A compact system that ran cartridges, the Game Boy was another Gunpei Yokoi creation, perfect for portable play. Despite its green and gray display, it became one of Nintendo's longest-lived successes, fending off full-color challengers like the Sega Game Gear and Atari Lynx. Nintendo reissued and revamped the Game Boy several times. The system came in a variety of colors in 1995, while the Game Boy Pocket presented a smaller frame and sharper screen the following year. The Game Boy Light and its illuminated display remained exclusive to Japan. Successful as it was, by 1990, the Famicom hardware was 7 years old. Facing competition from a new generation of rival systems, Nintendo debuted the Super Famicom in Japan, boasting 16-bit hardware vastly superior to the original Famicom. A year later, North America got the Super NES, internally the same as the Super Famicom, but outwardly more angular and purple. the Super NES wouldn't dominate the market as the NES had, thanks to competition from the Sega Genesis, but it enjoyed a robust game library as well as add-ons and variants. The Super Game Boy and the Japan-only Super Game Boy 2 let the console run Game Boy games, and Sharp released the Nizo TV SF-1 with a built-in Super Famicom. Although, not every add-on saw the light of day. A CD system that Nintendo co-developed with Sony never made it to the market. Among the add-ons for Nintendo's 16-bit system, the Satellaview was the most ahead of its time. Available only in Japan starting in 1995, the Satellaview attached to the system and let players download games through a satellite network. The Virtual Boy mystified much of the game-playing public in 1995. Designed by Gunpei Yokoi, the system displayed stereoscopic 3D graphics with a red and black palette. Despite a big initial promotion, Nintendo abruptly discontinued the Virtual Boy after 8 months of lukewarm reception. It remains Nintendo's shortest-lived system, and its library numbers only 24 games across America and Japan. Yet as the Virtual Boy sputtered, the next major evolution in Nintendo consoles waited just around the corner. The Nintendo 64 embraced the industry-wide move to 3D games and multiplayer, featuring four controller ports. Yet its cartridge format was expensive next to the CD-based Sony PlayStation, itself a descendant of Nintendo and Sony's aborted Super NES CD project. If the Nintendo 64 didn't have the widespread support of the NES or Super NES, it still did well with games either made or published by Nintendo. The Nintendo 64 DD add-on fared worse. Originally intended to combat CD-based systems, it saw a quiet, Japan-only release in 1999. Though Nintendo supported it for 2 years, the 64DD catalog started at a mere 10 titles. In 2003, the Nintendo 64 re-emerged in a weird way as the IQ Player, a plug-and-play system available only in mainland China that included several Nintendo 64 titles. Nintendo didn't stray far in crafting the Game Boy's first true successor. Released in 1998, the Game Boy Color sports a familiar design, but features a color screen, more powerful hardware, and an infrared port. The Game Boy Color's biggest booster in the late 90s was an original Game Boy game, Pokémon. The Pokémon craze also inspired Nintendo's smallest cartridge-based handheld with Pokémon Mini, and two Pokémon Pikachu devices played off the virtual pet craze. The Game Boy Advance brought Nintendo's handheld legacy full circle. The GBA switched the Game Boy's vertical layout for a horizontal one, and its graphics resembled those of Super NES games. With little competition, the Game Boy Advance lasted long enough for several redesigns. The SP introduced a flip-open style and a front-lit screen, while a backlit version of it followed in 2005, alongside the exceptionally small Game Boy Micro. The GameCube found Nintendo embracing the CD format, or at least a disc format about half the size of a regular CD. The compact system had four controller ports, and featured the ability to connect a Game Boy Advance as an interactive second screen for select games. The Game Boy Player attached to the bottom of the GameCube, allowing it to run Game Boy Advance games. More obscure is the Panasonic Q, a Japan-exclusive GameCube model with a DVD player. It sounded strange in concept, a hinged handheld with a touch-sensitive screen beneath its gameplay field. Yet the Nintendo DS amassed an impressive library of games, whether they used the touchscreen to great effect or ignored it completely. Nintendo put the DS through redesigns. The sleeker DS Lite followed, along with the internet-capable DSi and the supersized DSi XL. With the DS well-received, Nintendo was about to gamble their next console on a whole new way to play games. The Wii was a daring concept, an entire home console that revolved around a motion-sensing controller. Catching on with mainstream audiences as well as devoted gamers, the Wii was a smash. The original Wii featured GameCube controller ports, as well as backward compatibility. These features vanished from the 2011 redesign of the Wii, and the 2012 Wii Mini further stripped down the system by removing any online connection. Nintendo introduced the 3DS with a gimmick, a three-dimensional effect controlled by a slider switch. No glasses required. Beyond that, the 3DS improves on the Nintendo DS with more advanced hardware and extensive online capabilities. Its revisions include the larger 3DS XL, as well as the new 3DS and new 3DS XL, both of which feature additional buttons and processing power. The 2DS and its new 2DS XL successor both omitted the 3D effect. Nintendo stuck close to the Wii for its replacement. The Wii U's main console looks strikingly similar to the basic Wii and is backward compatible with Wii games and accessories. However, its true innovation lies in the Wii U's controller, which combines a large touchscreen with traditional inputs. Though it followed the Wii's example, the Wii U struggled to match it in sales and third-party support during its 5 years on the market. Seizing on the Wii U's greatest innovation, the Nintendo Switch stands between a portable system and a firmly planted home console. The tablet-sized Switch accommodates side-mounted controller attachments for portable play, but it also fits into a mount and connects to a TV. 2016 saw Nintendo return to its roots with dedicated plug-and-play consoles. With nostalgic appeal, the NES Classic Edition and Classic Mini Family Computer are palm-sized versions of the original NES and Famicom, containing slightly different collections of 8-bit games. The Super NES and Super Famicom Classic Editions once again repackage beloved older systems, housing somewhat differing lineups of quintessential 16-bit games. If there's one philosophy that defines Nintendo's console history, it's a combination of innovation and experimentation. And while they've had their misses, Nintendo, more than any other console manufacturer, has revolutionized the space over and over again.
Hello, everybody. Today we're going to read another short book. The title of the book is In the Garden by Oxford Reading Tree. Kipper went into Chip's room and picked up the magic key. The key began to glow. "Oh, help!" said Kipper. Kipper ran outside and looked for Biff and Chip. "Help!" he called. "The key is glowing." Biff and Chip were playing with Wolf and Wilma. They were playing in the sand pit. "Look at the magic key," called Kipper. Biff was cross with Kipper. "Come on, everyone," she yelled. "Run inside. Get to the magic house." It was too late. The magic began to work. The children got smaller and smaller. The children were in the grass and everything looked big. The grass was like a jungle. "What big flowers," said Kipper. Chip saw a bumblebee. He didn't like it and he didn't like the jungle. "Let's get out of here," he called. The children came out of the jungle. They came to a mountain. "What a big mountain," said Wolf. Chip began to climb. He wanted to get to the top. "Come on," he said. "Let's climb up." The children got to the top. Kipper was hot. "I don't like climbing mountains," he said. The children looked at the sand. "It looks like a desert," said Biff. "Let's go down." "Oh no," said Kipper. "Look at the toy car," said Wilma. "Let's get inside and ride down. We can ride down to the desert." Whoosh! The car took them down the mountain. "This is fun," said Wilma. The car stopped in the sand. The children climbed out. "Oh no," said Wolf. "Look at that big cat." The children climbed inside a bottle. Kipper was frightened. "I don't like this," he said. The cat looked inside the bottle. It pushed it with its paw. "Go away, cat," shouted Kipper. "Shoo," everyone yelled. Floppy chased the cat away. The children climbed out of the bottle. Good old floppy, said Biff. They walked over the desert. Everyone felt very hot. I want a drink, said Kipper. Look, said Wolf. Giant strawberries. The children ran to eat them. I love strawberries, said Chip. So do I, said Wolf. The children ate the strawberries. They pulled off big lumps. Kipper licked his lips. I like this adventure now, he said. It began to rain. What big drops, said Wilma. I feel sick now, said Kipper. So do I, said Chip. The children ran to a giant flower pot. They hid under it. The key began to glow. The magic was over. I can't see, said Chip. He had the flower pot on his head. I like the hat, said Wilma. Dad looked at his strawberries. I don't know, he said. There must be giant slugs around here. This is the end of the video. Bye!